This show is part of the RetroZap.com podcast network.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Hello, I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And welcome to another fully armed and operational edition of Podcast Stardust. This is the galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. And before we get to this week's review of Kylo Ren number 3 and number 4, Jay, where can we be found around the internet?
We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we can be reached by email at podcaststardust@retrozap.com.
So as I just said, we're going to be getting into a discussion and review of the final two issues of the Kylo Ren miniseries that was put out by Marvel, and those would be issues number 3 and 4. This will be a full spoiler discussion, and as a reminder, this series was written by Charles Soule with art by Will Sliney, the colorist was Guru EFX, and the letter was VC's Travis Lanham. And with that being said, Jay, if you can go ahead and give us a summary of the final two issues.
Sure. After consulting Snoke, Ben Solo has finally caught up to the Knights of Ren on Varnak. He declares his desire to join them, but Ren demands the price of joining their ranks is a good death. So, Ben describes a confrontation with the surviving Jedi of Luke Skywalker's temple. Vo, Ty, and Hennix caught up with Ben on Elfrona, a world that was home to an old Jedi temple. During the confrontation, Ben inadvertently killed Hennix when he reflected Hennix's own lightsaber back at him. He then collapsed the Jedi Temple on top of Vo and Ty. Despite being responsible for Hennix's death, Ren denies it is a good death because Ben didn't really want it. However, he lets Ben tag along with them anyway because Snoke vouched for him. On Mimban, the Knights of Ren and Ben are looking for an artifact called the Mind Splinter. Ben uses the Force to read the mind of one of the inhabitants to find the artifact, but Ren has the Knights of Ren kill everyone anyway. When they move to confront more of the mine's inhabitants, Ben objects to killing the innocent when Vo and Ty arrive after freeing themselves from the temple on Elfrona. Despite Ty's best efforts to convince Ben to stay true to the light, Ben ultimately succumbs to the dark when Ren snaps Ty's neck with the Force. Ben then earns a good death when he kills Ren in combat, after which the Knights of Ren swear allegiance to him. Aboard the Knight ship, Ben bleeds a crystal and constructs his iconic cross-hilt lightsaber as a dark voice asks him, "What is your name?"
Yeah. So, quite the conclusion to the series. What did you think about this one overall?
Oh, yeah. Well, I think I liked 4 a little bit better than 3. But of course, you know, 3, there's a lot of stuff going on in 3, though. We get to see Ben as a youngest we've ever seen him in this one. And all the flashbacks and everything just kind of leading us up to where we are. But wow, these are just, they're so good. They're so good. And I'm so glad that I've gotten back into the comic fold for these episodes.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely so. And you're right. When Ben is explaining to Ren, it can be confusing. You have to be careful.
Yes.
That, you know, his history with the Jedi, and he's explaining his relationship with the 3 Jedi that are pursuing him. We do see Ben as a very young child studying in the Force, and a younger Luke Skywalker than we've seen in some time, mm-hmm. as well, kind of helping guide them. But I don't want to hit every single plot detail in this discussion because there's quite a bit to get through, but there's some key moments to go over. So we're just going to go ahead and dive in with, you know, issue 3. It's so hard not to say episode.
I know. I keep saying episode 2. I caught myself as soon as I said it too. I was like, oh shoot, I meant to say issue.
Right. But so in issue 3, you know, they start off on the planet Varnak, and that's where Ben encounters Ren and the rest of the Knights of Ren. I really like the design of this facility. It's very Star Wars looking, very Star Wars and feeling. It's a central structure with a number of landing bays that are built up on stilts kind of coming up out of the swamp, but still it kind of blends elements of Naboo and Maz Kanata's castle. Mm-hmm. But it was a very inspired Star Wars design.
Oh, I agree. And it actually, from afar, it almost looks like an Imperial probe droid just from the overall like design and the structure of it. But it also kind of gives you almost, in a way, sort of a feeling of an Ewok village or even a village on Kashyyyk with the platform and everything there.
Yeah, except definitely
it's not wood, you know?
Yeah, like I said, it just... It screams Star Wars when you see it. We've never quite seen that design, but it very much is something that belongs in Star Wars. And so I thought it was very well done.
Absolutely. But
Ren then asks Ben, you know, what is it you want? And Ben tells him that, you know, he wants to travel and learn from them. And Ren points, well, yeah, you're strong in the shadow. I figured that out the first time I met you when Ben would have been, what, a young teenager or so, when they had that confrontation between Luke and the Knights of Ren in that same temple of Alfrana. And then, you know, Ren points out, well, you know, the price for joining us, it's a good death. So what do you got? And so Ben sits down to tell him the story about how he just evaded his former classmates. So we have Vo, who is the young woman with the white hair. And Ben describes her as someone that was always trying to measure up to him, but that she couldn't ever quite do it. She could never beat Ben. And that seemed to be a source of frustration for her, and it would frequently make her angry. Then, of course, there was Hennix, who was the Corrin, who looked at the Force as a puzzle, something to figure out, as opposed to something to just let flow through him. And we'll see that happen, come into play in just a bit. And then, of course, there was Ty, who was this bald human male who was very, very insightful. But what did you think of the three Jedi characters?
Well, like you said, you know, they're very different in their affinity for the Force and all at different kind of levels. And I think, you know, for the most part, it seems like they kind of look up to Ben in a way for just the fact that he is so gifted in it. But then, you know, you've also got Hennix, who is more the more calm, you know, in tune with what's going on in the Force kind of a thing. And he just seems to be a little bit more of an old soul, I guess you could say, when it comes to using the Force.
Right. Yeah, you know, it's interesting because a lot of what happens with these Jedi are things that make Ben's fall an eventuality here. Mm-hmm. And when they finally catch up to him in the temple, you know, Vo is determined to bring him to justice, that she's decided that he is guilty of all the things that he appears to be guilty of. And, you know, there was a lot of ambiguity with what happened. We know that Ben didn't actually kill Luke. He collapsed the hut on top of him. And then Luke withdrew from the Force. So that's why no one could detect him. And then something destroyed the Jedi Temple, but it was not actually Ben himself that did so. And so there's a lot of people jumping to conclusions. And so Vo goes charging off after him. And meanwhile, Hennix and Ty, especially Ty, are a bit more reserved about this, which is, you know, are we really pursuing the right path here? Don't we kind of need to reason with Ben and find out what happened? But I think there's something to what Ben was saying, especially when it comes to Vo, about how she was always angry that she couldn't measure up. And this is almost her opportunity to prove that she could.
Yes. And I think this kind of harkens back even to the first issue, too, when we get introduced to them at first as well, that they just seem kind of disjointed. You know, in the way of their fighting styles and just the way that they approached what they were doing. And so this kind of comes full circle to explain maybe why they were the way that they were in their fighting styles and then the way that they saw the Force in general.
Right. So the Jedi then go to confront Ben, and, you know, Vo leads the charge, and they kind of end up on a cliff. And Ben reaches out with the Force and throws her off the side, but then he immediately catches her. The problem is that Hennix is coming up behind Ben and doesn't see that Ben caught her with the Force. And so he throws his saber, also in anger, at Ben, who then reflects it back at Hennix with the Force, and it ends up killing Hennix. And so it was more of an accident than anything.
Mm-hmm.
But there's something I noticed as I was going through these two issues today. I'm going to make a note. I want you to make a note here because we're going to come back to this when we get through issue 4. Ben did not kill Hennix with his own saber. Hennix died by his own blade here.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Just keep that in mind because we'll get back to that discussion in just a bit. But then Ben basically forces Ty and Vo back into the temple and collapses it on top of them. I wasn't sure exactly what his intent was there. Do you think it was murderous intent or it was a stop following me intent?
I kind of got the stop following me vibe, quite honestly. I think he got nervous almost and he mm-hmm. was unsure. And so he just kind of reacted in a way that, gosh, how do I want to say it? It was just instinctual, I guess you could say. And it mm-hmm. was more like, I want to go this path, but I don't want to involve you, but yet I know I have to, but this is the way, you know what I mean? It's
sure.
It's that's kind of a really bad explanation, but yeah, I do feel like he was just trying to hold him back.
Yeah. Leave me alone. And yes. I can't, you know, mm-hmm. and all I can do to make that happen right now is to give myself a head start. So mm-hmm. there you go. But then we find out that Vo and Ty survived. They get out of the temple and they discover Hennix's body. And they know that Ben is headed off to the Knights of Ren. And at this point, they've determined that Ben is lost, which I'm not certain was actually a fair assumption to make given everything that happened. But I guess they didn't see how it was that Hennix died. There's a very big line of sight problem mm-hmm. for this issue that no one could actually see what was happening based on where all the characters were positioned. But the other problem that Ben has is that Ren doesn't buy this as a good death because Ben didn't really want it. It's not enough to have killed somebody. You had to have wanted it. You had to have had that malice in place in order to do it. But he tells Ben, you could be useful and Snoke vouched for you. So we'll let you tag along and see if we can find that good death somewhere. And then they get him a cool new outfit. What did you think of that look?
Oh my gosh, I know this was all over Instagram and people were instantly sketching it all and that type of thing. And you know, it is a good precursor to what he ends up with, but it's almost like a flight suit slash, you know, introduction to the Knights of Ren kind of a thing. But if I could back up for just a couple of minutes here, there's a couple of things I want to point out about how I felt with the way that Ren was talking to Ben and his use of his mask. Mm-hmm. And there's always this kind of, he calls him his maybe friend and he keeps wanting, it's almost like he's baiting him just to see, okay, so I've heard a lot about this kid, but let's just see how far I can push him, sort of a thing. And so there's that one point too, where he says, I know the mask can be kind of intimidating, or I can't remember his exact words or something. So then he proceeds to intentionally take off his mask. And so I just thought that was so powerful of a message in terms of the way that he was relating to Ben. And it's kind of the same thing that we see in The Force Awakens when, you know, Rey accuses Ben, Kylo Ren, of saying you're a monster in a mask. And so then he takes it off.
That's a good connection. Yeah.
You know, and so that whole mask thing. And of course, you know, I'm always enamored with that, but that's the connection that I made. So I didn't want to, you know, lose that train of thought while I had it. But what do you think?
Well, there's something to that. I agree. There's a difference between Ren and Ben, though, when it comes to the mask, in that Ren is gleefully following this path of the shadow, you know, and is enveloped himself in the shadow at this point. And mm-hmm. the mask is, as he points out at some point, it has an effect on people, and very much like what, you know, when Ben becomes Kylo later, he has with him. But we've had other conversations on this podcast where, you know, what exactly that mask means to Ben. And it is, I find it frequently as a way for Ben to hide himself from reality, to kind of separate himself and the things he's doing. Mm-hmm. When he's wearing the mask, you know, it allows him to be Kylo and to go do those terrible things. You know, then eventually in The Last of the Jedi, and in The Last Jedi, he destroys the mask and he really embraces the identity of Kylo and continues to do awful things without it. But for a while, at least, the mask becomes something of a security blanket there, which I'm not sure it ever really was for Ren. It was more of an intimidation piece than what Kylo was using it for.
Yeah, and he's got that icy blue stare too, and you never know exactly what he's thinking.
Yeah, definitely. And you know, the other thing about Ren is that he has some sort of a relationship with Snoke, and really, he's the only one of the Knights of Ren that doesn't much in the way of talking in this entire thing. And he's leading the rest of them, and they all are content to follow someone who's more powerful in the Force. And, you know, but he's really just comes off as an extension of Snoke's will. And we all know who at this point is an extension of the Emperor's will, of Sidious's will at this point, which is the, you know, okay, well, sure, you killed somebody, but did you mean it? It's the, you know, you're going to have to want it, and you can't be tied up in this dogma, and, you know, you can't be worrying about other people. It's, you know, you're going to have to, you know, you're going to have to take a life simply because you want to. It was what was standing in your way. And it's a very, very different type of philosophy that's going on here. Well, was there anything else that you wanted to contribute on issue 3 before we turn to our attention to issue 4?
Well, one thing that I thought was really interesting is when Vo and Ty get out of the temple being crashed on them, the one thing that Vo says is, I don't care where Ben Solo's path takes him, Ty. I only care about where it ends. Mm-hmm. And I just thought that was so prophetic, you know, and I think that she's really feeling a lot of contempt for Ben at this point. And I think that she always kind of did, you know what I mean? Because she was always kind of in his shadow. And even though she wasn't supposed to feel that way as a Jedi, I think it always kind of bothered her. And now that he's starting to turn, you know, against them, that it's almost like a vengeance kind of a thing in a way, which is not the Jedi way. I don't know. How do you feel about that?
Well, I think that a lot of that's going to come out over the course of the fourth issue. And you're right that Ben called it, that she was always trying to measure up to Ben. She wanted to be the best in the class. And that's not what Luke's teaching was about. And now that, you know, Ben has apparently murdered Luke Skywalker, you know, she kind of has an excuse to go out there and prove that she was the better Jedi. And even though she's got no foundation for that belief, that Ben has always been able to top her and everything else, and she wasn't able to measure up. And so now we're going to see her get a couple of opportunities to, you know, jump in the ring with a champion and, you know, try and win that belt. So yeah, we'll definitely be getting into some more of that here in issue 4.
Right.
Well, issue 4 then picks up with, they're in the mid rim on the mine moon of Mimban.
Say that 10 times fast.
I said it very slow and deliberately for a reason.
You did a very good job.
And you may remember Mimban from Solo, a Star Wars Story, but, you know, we're now on the mine moon. And the Knights of Ren are there holding a group of aliens hostage. And Ren has commenced having his knights kill them unless they will reveal the location of an artifact who he wants, which, okay, it's called the Mind Splinter. And I couldn't help but wonder if the Mind Splinter is supposed to be an homage to Splinter of the Mind's Eye, which was that book by Alan Dean Foster that was initially set on Mimban before it was adapted for Solo. And so I don't know.
I didn't make that connection.
Yeah, I think that's got to be what that was about, because we never actually see this artifact anywhere.
Right, right.
But I don't know. What did you think? Is that makes sense?
That is awesome. Oh my gosh. I give you props for that one, because I never would have made that connection.
Oh, thanks. This is what happens when you outline the issues. Like, oh, wait a second. That reminds me of something. But anyway, so Ben is not on board with killing the, I'm not even sure what these aliens are. They kind of look like goggle-eyed Nictu. Do they seem familiar to you at all?
Yeah, that's what I was wondering too. They're almost like a cross between a Nictu and a Gran, almost, with the way that they have the eye stalks, you know?
Yeah, but Ben's not on board with killing them, and he says, wait, Ren, there might be another way. And so this is kind of the first time that we get to see him use this whole invasive mind technique. And he says Snoke taught it to him, that, you know, that's similar to a Jedi mind trick. And then he finds out where this artifact is, which is 3 levels below. And then Ren says, yeah, great. Oh, you are handy to have around. Go ahead and release them, gentlemen. And he's talking to the Knights of Ren. And then they go ahead and slaughter all of these aliens, whatever it is that they're called. And Ben's not happy about that, because that was the whole point of doing this mind trick, was to spare their lives.
Right. Which is interesting, because, you know, he's still got that sort of compassion element to him. He hasn't completely, you know, fallen to the shadow just yet. He wants that part of that, but he's not quite there yet.
Right. So this is where we start seeing a couple instances of Snoke or somebody else kind of, it's not off screen, but kind of in a side panel making statements about the Jedi or the Force or whatever. But we got Snoke, and it's a close up on Snoke's mouth from in profile, saying that the Jedi have rules that they believe made them stronger. It actually made them more rigid and easily broken. Mm-hmm. And this is kind of in response to Ben's objection to them killing these innocent people that are inhabiting the mine because they got the information that they wanted. And that's not what a Jedi does. And then he follows this up with, the Knights of Ren do as they please and they're fluid. They don't let anything stand in their way. And so this is kind of describing, you know, where Ben is headed with this. And then when they get down to the aliens, you know, one of them is very defiant and says, you know, we're never going to turn over this mind splinter to you. And Ren then commands the knights to go ahead and attack them. And Ben is very reluctant. And Ren's like, you know, I'm beginning to question whether you're worthy of Snoke's recommendation here. The mm-hmm. reference is not quite checking out. Yeah, and so the Knights of Ren began killing Ben, and Ben's kind of running out of time here. Well, the same Ty and Bo show up, and you want to talk about some terrible timing. This the all-time worst timing. I'm not sure if they didn't show up, if Ben ultimately falls to the dark side here. I'm not saying he might not ever, but I'm not sure that it happens here. What did you think?
Oh, yeah, because, I mean, you can see that Ren is kind of almost baiting Ben the whole time and, you know, kind of, like you said, throwing that out there, like, I don't know if this recommendation is worth it or not. It's almost like Ben is the Knights of Ren intern at this point, you know. But, yeah, as soon as Vo and Ty show up, you can kind of just see that look on Ben's face as he looks up at them, and they're just seething as they look mm-hmm. at him. And then you get that image of him, almost the same thing as you see in The Rise of Skywalker when he reaches behind him to get the lightsaber, you know, through Rey in the Force. Yeah. And it's that same image, but that look on his face is like, okay, the past. They represent the past to me. So if I'm going to go in, it's in for a penny, in for a pound. And yeah, I think at that point it was, yeah, he was all in.
Right. Because Ren asks Ben, who are they? They're clearly Jedi. I don't know why Ren had to ask that. But Ben says they're the past. And this immediately brought to mind the line from The Last Jedi, you know, let the past die, kill it you have to.
Yes.
And again, I believe that that's got to be deliberate. This is where he learned that lesson. You know, mm-hmm. they were standing in the way of him becoming who he was meant to be, or so he would believe later.
Right.
And so as it turns out, Vo goes to confront the Knights of Ren while they are slaughtering all these innocent people. And meanwhile, Ty is trying to talk some sense into Ben, and he is reminding him that, you know, you're acting like you don't have control when every single step is a step that, you know, is one of your own choice. You're making decisions here. And, you know, Ben responds, you know, this is my path now. And Ben says he has no choice for a couple of reasons. One, his name wasn't his choice. He already objected in the first two issues of the series that, you know, he was given the name Ben Solo. And those are such major names in the galaxy that come with all kinds of weight and expectations on them. And that both the light side and the dark side claimed him when he was born.
Yes.
And furthermore, neither Snoke or Luke saw him as a person, just a legacy, a set of expectations. This was some awesome writing. I mean,
you're not kidding.
You know, there's been a lot of great comics that have featured Kylo, and in this case, Ben, in the past year, whether it was the Age of Resistance, Kylo Ren, #1, Supreme Leader Snoke, #1, actually had a lot of amazing things to say about Ben as well. And now this, just really pouring out all this great stuff about Ben Solo / Kylo Ren that we just didn't quite get in the movies.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, and it's just it's so great because you can see the struggle happening here. And this issue is everything that I had hoped that it would be. And I know that, you know, for everyone that was looking forward to the series, this is the culminating moment because, mm-hmm. you know, Ty is basically pleading with him saying, you know, a path goes in two directions and you always have a choice. And he is connected to Ty through the Force. And Ben keeps saying, I wish we weren't. And so you're right. That mantra that he says, you know, let the past die, kill it if you have to. You know, he's been saying that in his head over and over and over again just to convince himself. And this is, it's just so powerful.
Right. And so Ty seems to be just about to get through to him. He's lost his weapon. He's there at Ben's mercy. And mm-hmm. he says, you know, there's always hope. You know, you could heal people and make a difference. You could bring more light to the galaxy. And Ben tells, you know, be the man that I know who you are, that I know you are. Just be who. And at that point, Ty's neck snaps. And we're left with a moment of ambiguity as to who did this. Because the way Ben's looking around, at least I wasn't certain that he didn't do it until Ren shows up on the next page. And basically Ben confronts him and Ren says, you know, Snoke was wrong with you about you. And, you know, you're fighting this thing every step of the way. You don't want to live in the shadow. And Ren confirms that he was the one that snapped Ty's neck. And I think at that point, at least, because much like Vader, who gets redeemed later, this is where Ben snapped. And he says, when Ren says to him, you don't want to live in the shadow, Ben says, true, I am the shadow. And, Ren then like comes back with I just kind of thought it was him trash talking almost, tough talk. Have you ever been in a fight where the other guy wants to kill you? It's just kind of like, I have, Ken. I mean, you could just see this mm-hmm. playing out at a weigh-in almost. And then we get some more of this imagery that I was talking about earlier, where we get images of Sidious now off of the side. It's a really good thing that this issue came out after The Rise of Skywalker.
Yeah.
Because it's Sidious saying, now you will be who you are, who you were always meant to be. Mm-hmm. And so what did you think about this fight?
Oh my gosh. I mean, like I said, there was so much to this, and I love the way that he grabbed the other lightsaber, and just I have to say the hilt design was pretty cool too. But when you were saying about him looking back or looking around, I think part of it was that he couldn't actually realize that he had just done that. Mm-hmm. And it almost it reminded me too of even with Anakin and Padme on Mustafar, when he reached out and force choked her, it was almost like he lost sight of who he was. Mm-hmm. And I think the same thing happened to Ben at that point with Ty, but he was going forward and knew what he was doing, but yet it was that moment that he lost himself. And oh my gosh, this fight was just so great with the two lightsabers and just the exchange that they were saying back and forth. And Snoke was completely wrong about you. You're fighting this every step of the way. And then, and then Ben is going right back at him. I am the shadow. And oh my gosh, it was so good.
Yeah.
So good.
And I loved how, while this is going on, because we get this overhead look of the pathway that they're on, because it's the same pathway that Ty just died on. And then you've got these in the corners. You've got these images of all these other force users standing around, and we get Snoke saying, yes, my boy, yes. And then, Leia right underneath him, Ben. Ben. Yes.
Oh.
And then on the other side, you see an image of Rey with Unkar Plot, and she says, you feel that? It feels cold.
Yes.
And
oh my gosh. And this is the weirdest thing of Rey. This doesn't even look like Rey. When I looked at it, I was like, no, that's not Rey. But yes, it is Rey.
I think they were trying to make her look
conflict.
A little younger, and it didn't mm-hmm. quite come out the way they intended. But then underneath that, it's Sidious, yes, claim your birthright and strike him down. So Sidious right there is confirming exactly what Ben was saying, is that, mm-hmm. He was never... he was a legacy, at least to the dark side part of this, and that, a set of expectations, and that's what Sidious wants, is trying to get out of him. And then, Ren's goading him, you aren't special, Ben, to which he responds, I'm not special. I can do whatever I want, which mm-hmm. is exactly the philosophy of the Knights of Ren that we've been hearing about for the previous three issues.
Right. Yes. And those whole couple pages with all of the conflict, I mean, that is, it's so perfect. It just embodies everything with, like you said, with Leia and with Rey and everything. And just, I feel cold because we've always known that the dark side feels cold. And just that look that Ben is giving to Ren as he's going over top of him. Other people think I'm special. I don't. And oh man, that was so good.
Yeah. And so he goes ahead and he kills Ren. Did you notice with whose saber?
I have to go back and look at that. Is it Ty's saber?
Yes. So he's now killed Ren with Ty's saber. He killed Hennix with Hennix's saber. He kills Ren with Ty's saber.
Yes, because Ty's has the two almost like orbs on it. Yes.
Exactly. Well, then he goes to confront Vo. And Vo says, you killed the master. And Ben says, of course I did. I'm a murderer. And then he goes on, you're not a Jedi. Nobody's left to train you. Why do you want to even live? And then he kills Vo. And who does he kill Vo with? Which saber does he kill Vo with, I should say?
Ren's.
Yes, right. So he has not killed anybody with his own lightsaber.
His own saber. And good call.
It's almost exactly like the mask. As long as he's using Ben's saber, he's Ben. But he can do a whole lot of other things with everybody else's saber. Maybe I'm reaching there, but that seemed to stand out to me.
That's a good connection.
And then at this point, he's been collecting all these sabers the entire time. And the Knights of Ren then kneel to him and essentially accept him as the new leader. This is so Sith here. You know, he gets goaded into killing the leader of the Knights of the Ren, much the same way Anakin was goaded into killing Darth Tyrannus. And then later the Emperor tried to goad Luke into killing Darth Vader to become the new apprentice. And, you know, again, it's such a good thing that this came out after The Rise of Skywalker, because that would have really given a whole lot of stuff away before you were ready for that.
It definitely. And I love this whole imagery with the Knights of Ren just bowing at his feet. And then he's got his eyes closed, and it's almost like he's just drinking in this power at this point. And I also like how he's got this is neither here nor there, but me doing the fashion stuff, where he has his lightsaber behind his back. Like, you know, we saw him pull out before, but that's where he's actually keeping it, which is kind of interesting. Usually you see it on the belt.
Yeah. So he's now, you know, the Ren, so to speak. And they leave in the Knights of Ren ship, which is that black elongated looking thing that we saw quite a bit of in The Rise of Skywalker. And he's standing there at a workbench with his shirt off, which I guess is what he likes to do in his spare time, based on what we saw in The Last Jedi.
Ben Solo.
Yeah. And he's removing the crystal. It looks like from his saber. It was kind of hard to tell. And then he bleeds it. You know, I don't know if you read the Darth Vader series that Charles Soule wrote, when Vader bled the crystal from Master Infala, which was the Jedi that he found and killed and took his saber so that he could construct his own Sith saber. But back in that series, you know, Palpatine set Vader on that task of building his Sith lightsaber and acquiring a crystal, and they don't just hand out crystals. The crystals had to be taken from a Jedi, and that's why Vader had to hunt down this Master Infala and kill him and take his crystal, and took it back to Mustafar and he bled it. You know, Kylo's just doing it here on the spot. And it took everything Vader had to bleed that crystal. The crystal fought back and gave him Force visions, where he ended up surrendering himself to Obi-Wan Kenobi for judgment. And, you know, it nearly ruined Vader. Meanwhile, Ben's doing it here without the help of a dark side shrine, which I found intriguing. I just can't tell if he's using his own crystal or one of the other crystals. What's your take on that?
I think, looking back at the different hilts, I think it is his crystal, because it's definitely not Hennix's. It's definitely not Ty's, because that one's just so unique. And then Vo's has kind of like almost like a petal, I would say, or a leaf kind of coming off the top of the hilt. So right. I think it is his.
So that says something to me. Does it say anything to you?
Oh, yeah. Let the past die. I mean, that's
exactly.
Yeah. He's killing it. And he's doing it with the power of his lineage, basically. Because as you said, he's doing this without that other use of the tool that he would need to do this. And it's just of his own power. He's just grasping the crystal, and the whole ship and everything, I mean, is you just see this red lightning kind of encompassing it. And then as it finally bleeds, you can tell that it puts him into almost this state of again, just seeing all of these people in his life, and even Chewbacca and Lando at this point. Yep. And, you know, and then everything just it turns to red.
Right.
And then he opens his hand, and there it is.
Yeah, as you're saying, you know, the Chewbacca and Lando there, Luke, Han, Ty, and Leia are also you know, images around them. And, you know, this is the past that he's killing to become what, you know, again, he's supposed to be met. So when he finishes the process, he opens his fist and their crystals cracked in his hand. He goes to put it in his old saber, which shorts out. And then he builds the iconic cross hilt saber with a vent on the sides for that, as that dark side voice, you know, what is your name? And I'm assuming that voice had to be Snoke's at that point.
It's got to be, yeah. And Snoke, or even the Emperor, which is Snoke, essentially. So.
Right. And then, of course, the answer to that question is the ignition of the new saber, the cross-hilt saber. He doesn't actually say Kylo Ren, but given that the title of the series is The Rise of Kylo Ren, I think it's a, you know, we all know what the answer to that question is, of course.
Exactly.
But
exactly.
Whew, what an amazing series. What are thoughts do you have on this?
Well, I know that we've discussed before about, you know, why did he pick the name Kylo? And I know I've always said that I feel like it's a combination of like Skywalker and Solo, mm-hmm. you know, and so that's where he gets the Kai from Skywalker and L-O from Solo. So
let me ask you a question about that.
Yeah.
But given that how he upset he was about being given the name Ben Solo and all mm-hmm. the baggage that and the expectations that came with it, why would he pick a name like that that would blend, you know, Skywalker and Solo, you know, two names that are absolutely enormous in the galaxy?
Well, I think because one of the things is the name Ren mm-hmm. to me stands for something short for render. And when you render something, you separate it. So perhaps this is his way of separating himself from his legacy by actually using the name, almost like a, you know, I spit in the face kind of thing.
Yeah, I'm really curious about this because it was issue two when he was consulting with Snoke. They're going over this whole thing where, you know, Ben says how he hates his name because, mm-hmm. you know, it wasn't one he chose. And then everyone expects him to be Obi-Wan Kenobi, someone he never met. And his last name is Solo, and everyone knows his father. And then Snoke sees in his mind, it's like, oh, you've picked out a name for yourself already. And Ben says, well, when I was a child, but it's stupid. And to which Snoke responded, no, it's perfect. Because when we're children, we don't practice self-deception. Mm-hmm. We don't delude ourselves. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, again, I'm not saying you're wrong. It's the notion that he picked that name before he even knew what the Knights of Ren were.
True.
And so, and again, at that point, now that we're talking it out, I'm actually kind of coming right around to some of your ways of thinking on this, because that was before he hated Skywalker and Solo, mm-hmm. you know, as a kid. And so, you know, Kylo may have been a way of disguising that legacy a little bit for him.
Mm-hmm. And it's just kind of like, too, it just harkens back to the old ways of the Sith that they would pick their own name. Mm-hmm. And, you know, kind of thinking about Darth Bane and the name that he chose based upon the most horrible thing in his entire life, which was his father abusing him. And his father always called him the bane of his existence. So he was actually using the name as a source of power. And so that's the only thing that, you know, that kind of makes me think that maybe that was one of the reasons why he would actually use that and then render his past from him. So who knows? Mm-hmm. I mean, I guess we'll have to see.
Definitely. Definitely. This is such an incredible series. I really loved it. Charles Soule, for my money, is the best writer bar none of Star Wars comics. And I can't wait to see what he does with the rest of the Star Wars series that he's currently writing. And then the High Republic novel coming out later this year.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So do you think we'll ever get the answer to the reason why he chose his name?
No, I think we got as much detail as we're going to get. Is, you know, something he picked out for himself when he was a kid and then he just didn't use it. But when, you know, forging this new identity, letting the past die, that's what he went to. It was something that he just grown up with. And I think at this point, I'd almost be a little disappointed if they spelled it out for us.
Yeah, I can see that, too. Like, there's something to be said for leaving things to mystery.
Yeah.
Don't pull back the curtain too much.
Yeah. And I, unfortunately, on some level, I think that's kind of what's happened with Leia, Luke, and Han, is that we've had so many books, we've had so many comics about them that every detail of their life has been covered, and there's not enough just to be left to the viewer or reader's imagination. And I kind of like that we can put the pieces together, that we don't have to be petted on they don't have to pet us on the head and hold our hand all the way through this one. So I like it this way. But any other final thoughts?
No, I just really love the series, and I wish that there was more, honestly. I just think that everything was so well told, and visually as well as through the wording, and yeah, it had me hinged panel by panel. Loved it. Yeah.
Maybe we'll get a series someday, the reign of Kylo Ren or the legacy of Kylo Ren. Ooh. And we can get more stories about him and the Knights of Ren before we get to the events of The Force Awakens. I'd be on board for that.
So. I would love that.
All right. Well, this has been a lot of fun. Thank you all for listening to another episode of Podcast Stardust and our discussion of The Rise of Kylo Ren, issues number 3 and 4. We'd like to remind you that you can find all episodes of Podcast Stardust on Retrozap, Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, Overcast, wherever it is that you get your podcasts, we can be found there. And of course, we are part of the Retro Zap Podcast Network. And if you subscribe to the network feed, you can find all the great Retro Zap shows in one place. If you've got a minute of spare time, and I suspect you might, given the current conditions right now, we'd love it if you could head over to Apple Podcasts or iTunes, whichever you prefer to call it, and drop us a 5-star review with a couple sentences about what it is that you like about the show. As I say, every episode, that really does help others find the show, especially in a very crowded niche of podcasts. And people just like seeing podcasts that have reviews and 5 stars when they're looking for something new to listen to. And please share our show with your friends on social media. And speaking of which, Jay, where can they find us on the internet and social media?
Well, you can find us in a variety of places. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. If you want to reach out to Dennis on Twitter, he is at DJKVER2, and I am at Joyce Krebs. You can also check out our Pinterest page. We have a YouTube channel, and you can email us your thoughts at podcaststardust@retrozap.com. Have you read this series? And if you have, what did you think? Did we miss anything? We could definitely have spent a heck of a lot more time talking about it, but you know, time is of the essence. So podcaststardust@retrozap.com. We'd love to hear your thoughts. You can also share your thoughts with us over on our Discord channel. We have a room over on the RetroZap server, and you can figure out how to do that just by going to our show notes. And we have a lot of really great conversations over there in our room, as well as all the other great RetroZap shows. They have their own rooms as well as dedicated rooms to things like Star Wars lore and spoilerific talks about things like the Clone Wars. So the last thing is to check us out on TeePublic, and we are teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust. And we have a bunch of great show logo designs over there, designed by our own good friend, Corey Club from Coffee with Kenobi. So we'd love it if you could check those out.
All right. Well, that'll do it then for episode 81 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.